Welcome to the Sunrise Safari. My name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Dangerous Dave on camera. We have Jamie and Viam out on the other vehicle, and we have Geraldine flying solo in final control this morning. So a very warm welcome. It's about 24 degrees Celsius, 78 Fahrenheit. You can see, as Dave showed you, there's a bit of cloud cover coming in. Now we're on our way to the eastern boundary, see if we can find that new leopard again. So very exciting. See if we can continue the habituation process. I know Jamie's heading off to see if she can find the Nkomo ladies, but a very excited morning, and I'm thrilled to have all of you out on the back of the vehicle with us. So let's go see what misadventures or adventures we can get up to. So, hi Dee. Dee says she's been gone for 2 days. Seems like I've missed a lot. What interesting stuff's happened, apart from me being covered in cobwebs right now. Dee, we found a mystery leopard. Probably a young male, around 4 or 5 years old, and he killed a young kudu. And he runs from cars, so we've been slowly edging our way closer and closer from quite a distance from him. And I'm hoping, now that it's still a little bit dark in the early morning, that he's still got some of that kudu kill there, and he's gonna be a little bit more relaxed. He started calming down very nicely on the sunset safari last night, and it's just taking your time and having a bit of patience. The worst thing to do with an animal that's slightly skittish with vehicles is drive straight in at him. So we've been stopping a distance away, slowly sneaking forward, and one of the things you've got to do, which often people don't realize, is everyone tries to whisper, and then that doesn't actually work. So I've been slowly raising my voice, how I speak, just to get him used to the sound of people speaking, and hopefully with some more positive reinforcement, he'll become a nice leopard to view. I don't think it's going to be tomorrow, but it'll take a couple of months, and hopefully we'll be able to introduce the new leopard. Now, he is a young male, so he's a dispersal male, so we're not sure where he's going to stay around, but I think I have been seeing his tracks in this area between Buffleshoek and Juma, and he has gone down into Torchwood, so I think more cobwebs everywhere. Tickling my nose, just sort of right at the edge of it there. So we're nearly there. So he was just over there. Now, unless hyenas have stolen his kill, he could have moved his kill to put in a tree last night. We don't know yet, but very, very exciting. And also, Jamie's been having some great lion luck, and the Birminghams have been around. They departed yesterday. But speaking of Jamie and lions, let's go see how her tracking of the Nkomo girls is going.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. On this somewhat warmer than usual morning in the middle of autumn, we're on our way to check up and see if we can't find the Nkomos, the lionesses that we had stalking a herd of impala last night. We'll see if they managed to succeed or if they decided to wander further west in the direction that they were going. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, my name is Jamie. I have Viam on camera with me this morning. Not only are we here to look for the Nkomos and the lionesses, we're also here to double check and see if Tingana's decided to pop out of the block that he was in yesterday. Last tracks we had, we're going straight into the block on my left. Let's go across to Brent, who has managed to find the animal. Oh. Okay. Hold on. We'll wait and see what's happening with Brent. Let's just wait a moment. As I was saying, Tingana has wandered into this block sometime yesterday morning whilst I was sitting with the Nkomo lionesses. and see if he hasn't decided to pop out. It's very windy, very cloudy, perfect hunting weather. There was some, just in case you were wondering, there was some slight confusion there with Brent and an animal. It was not the animal I was looking for. It was not the animal either of us were looking for, although we're always very happy to see one. But it was just a hyena racing across towards, or across over our eastern boundary and into Torchwood. Sometimes in the dark, animals start to look very similar. To just check down along Impala Road. Now, the interesting thing about yesterday's sighting was that the two Nkuhuma lionesses were on their own, missing the rest of the pride. So three lionesses are somewhere else. The question is, where is that somewhere else? And have they managed to reunite during the night? Last I heard, there were at least some Nkuhumas on Manuleti, so north of Buffalo's Hook. But the lionesses last night were very determinedly heading to the west, not to the north. I wonder if there isn't a chance that they are going to head across to meet up with the other three. The biggest problem at the moment in terms of tracking is that, as you, for those of you who are watching the sunset safari would know, there were lots and lots and lots of elephants around. And what they've done is they've sort of stomped all over the roads, as of course is their right. But there's a good chance that they've also stepped on tracks whilst they've been doing that. So we're going to have to check really, really carefully along this boundary road. Oh, morning, Impala. So this is where the lions were hunting last night. And there are lots and lots of Impala on this clearing. I'm turning off my lights, obviously not shining my spotlight on them. Although it's not too big of an issue at sort of this time of the morning because it is getting light again. So the threat levels are slowly reducing. Hello, little one. They are looking a little bit nervous, but I suppose who could blame them? Good morning, Errol. Errol joined us last night for our sunset safari, and what a wonderful drive to have joined on, Errol. It was a really, really enjoyable afternoon. You were just saying how excited you are to be joining us again on our sunset safari. Oh, sorry, sunrise. I'm getting my sunsets and my sunrises all confused now. It's wonderful to have you back with us. I'm going really slowly because this is where the Nkuhuma's tracks went off. Now, just because there are impala around does not mean that there are no predators. So any general game species, if they see a lion or a leopard, will actually stand and watch it and stick around the area, because that makes sense. It's not the big cat that you see that gets you, it's the one you don't see that gets you. So it's better to just keep an eye on them and keep a safe and healthy distance. Every impala, zebra, or wildebeest out here knows that they are capable of outrunning any one of the big cats, except possibly a cheetah. So it makes more sense to just stand and watch from a safe distance, even feed from a safe distance, and rely on the fact that a predator is unlikely to hunt and unlikely to show any predatory behavior towards them. And for the most part, that works fine. Every now and again, you'll find a leopard springs into action and surprises whatever happens to be wandering past it, like, for example, guinea fowl. That's why we're checking this road so carefully. So just the fact that there are impala here doesn't necessarily mean that there are no lions. It does, however, mean that the lions might have been successful last night. As I said, cold, cloudy weather with wind and minimal light. Morning, Imbalas. Well done for making it through the night. Definitely would have made them very, very nervous. Here you go, Red. You're saying at least we know that these guys that we're seeing survived so far? Absolutely, they definitely did, and they are nervous as a result. Imagine how scary it is being an impala as it starts to get dark. You've got the scent of lions wafting around somewhere. You've got the smell, but you can't tell exactly where it's coming from because the wind is gusting. The trees are rustling everywhere, so you can't hear if something's trying to sneak up on you. And you know that you've got at least 8 hours of this before the sun starts to rise once again. Imagine what that must feel like, to go to sleep like that. It's not like they can go home and tuck themselves safely away in bed. They've just got to stand and hope that if something does happen, it doesn't happen to them. And then from the lioness's side, very empty-bellied cats last night. They were hungry looking. So it's a difficult one. It's always that toss-up. The night's game of who lives and who doesn't. I'm just checking very carefully down this road. You know, I can actually see, I'll stop at a nice viewpoint of the horizon, but I can actually see rain to the west of us. Did you see that as well, Vim? That would be a surprise. That would definitely not be what I was expecting. Usually it gets trapped there on the mountains and it doesn't make its way all the way across to us. And I mean, if you look as we're driving into the east, it certainly doesn't look as though rain is on the cards from this side. See, patches of sky coming through. We shall see. I will be very surprised if we get rained out. Zumi Mike has asked me to give the size of the Juma and Arethusa Traverse in miles. And Zumi Mike, the miles is going to be really hard for me to do. Perhaps I can ask you guys to convert for me. It would be really helpful. I'm sorry, it's the one I'm happy to convert most things, but area is not my strong suit. I can tell you that Juma by itself is about close to 1,300 hectares, quite a large area in this particular part of the Sabi Sands, and Arethusa falls somewhere around 600. So Juma is 5 square miles. Arethusa sits at around 600 hectares, which is 2 square miles. There we go. Thank you very much, Jerry, and Final Control. Much appreciated for converting and listening to me at the same time. Square miles has never been my strong suit, or area has never been my strong suit. Okay, so that's the area that we traverse, and Cheetah Plains will add on another 2 square miles after that. That being said, if you come and arrive as a guest at Juma, your traverse area is much, much larger. The guides from Juma can go across to Torchwood, to Bivilshoek, to Cheetah Plains as well. So that would equate to probably somewhere in the region of close to 6,000 to 8,000 hectares of traverse, if not more. What would that be? Close to 10 square miles, if not more. So the guests have a much larger range that they travel through. We've got our own little square. We've got our own little pocket of where we drive. And the nice thing about that, excuse me, is that we have come to know this area so well that as soon as something looks out of place or different, we immediately pick up on it. We've walked, we've known every bush, and we also get to know the animals well enough to start not predicting which way they're going to go, but hazarding lucky guesses that very often pay off. Let's put it that way. Lots and lots and lots of sleeping impala this morning. and as we sit and watch the Impala and question what kind of night they had last night, Natalie, who is a new viewer joining us for the first time, you were wondering if this is a show that happens or starts at the same time every single day. And the answer is yes. And depending on where you are, Natalie, I'll leave you to do the time zone conversions. But we start at the moment, or this month at least, we are starting at 5:30 Central African time in the morning. Continues on for 3 hours in the morning. And then we go back out again and are live again at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Central African time, until 7 o'clock. But that changes as the year goes on. So obviously now we in the Southern Hemisphere are going into winter. Our days are going to get shorter and shorter, and so our times in the morning will shift as that occurs, as will our times in the afternoon will move earlier. But that's not going to be happening for another... I'm not actually sure when that's happening. It must be fairly... Now that I think about it, it must be fairly soon. It is. I just didn't realize how far into March we were. All right, well, we'll keep you updated as to when that is changing, but for now, we are the same time every single day, Natalie. And I hope that you stick with us, because the most exciting things can happen out here. There's never a dull, at least never a dull day, let's put it that way. The sun's starting to come up and the clouds have started to clear, and as a result, I'm now freezing. Sorry, bear with me one moment. Not the best idea to drive and put a jacket on at the same time, but I did feel a little bit like I was about to keel over from hypothermia. That might be a slight exaggeration. And Clayton, you were wondering on the subject of the cold and the change of seasons. You were wondering, as where you are in autumn, there seem to be more spiders out and about, and you were wondering if it were the same here. Clayton, our sort of our peak time of seeing spiders is usually during our rainy season. So from about November until April. Because the thing about South Africa is that although I keep referring to this as autumn, South Africa doesn't really have four seasons. We have two seasons. We have a wet season and we have a dry season, and the wet season is hot and the dry season is cold. But we don't have the same clear four seasons that more temperate regions might do. And that's just because of these, our longitude and latitude, etc., especially in the low veld. Johannesburg, maybe up in the high veld, could be described as having more of a clear division between four different seasons. But back to your question, this year, I have seen more spiders in our autumn, which we have now entered into, but not because it is autumn and not because that's usual, but because this is when we actually got our rains. Our rains came very, very late and were very minimal, but nevertheless did arrive. I just want to stop and have a look at the clouds behind us and just see if the rain's going to come towards us. Now, usually from this perspective, you can see the Drakensberg Mountains. You can see right across the landscape. It all seems to be hidden beneath layers of cloud this morning. I didn't think it was meant to rain. It doesn't feel like it's going to rain. So maybe it's just not going to quite reach us here. Wouldn't be the first time we've watched rains roll up to our western boundary and then just stop. It has been so incredibly dry this year, which is why it's such a pleasure to see at least the grass recovering a little bit. Just before the start of our dry season, in theory, and the beginning of winter. Gary, you were wondering about whether or not any of the animals go into hibernation out here, and the answer is no, because it never gets really cold enough for them to do that. Hibernation is more for colder climates. The animals here, and I'm talking largely reptile species, maybe some insect species as well. The animals here go into periods of what's known as aestivation, A-E, aestivation. And that is what occurs when it's a very similar process to hibernation. The metabolism slows down. They start to go into an almost torpor-like state. But it is not quite as heavy as hibernation. So the reptiles in particular can come out and bask on slightly warmer days, heat themselves up. And that is to do with dry. So aestivation is like hibernation, but for dry instead of cold. And yes, certain animals do practice that. Tortoises, for example, and snakes. I wanted to check all around this road for tracks. I haven't picked up on any, so I want to change my direction and go through to the western boundary of Juma and even go on to Arethusa to check what's happening there. While I do that, let's find out how Brent's leopard search has been going.
So really exciting. He's been a good boy and he's listened and he's put that kudu carcass up a nice big marula tree. Now, Dave and I did get a brief visual of him on the ground, so we're staying far away. He's lying in a thicket where we can't see him nicely, but this is very good news. He's hoisted the carcass overnight. Still quite a bit of meat on it. So we'll definitely be coming back and checking during the drive, but for now, I think I'm just going to leave him be, let him relax down again, and then maybe pop through a little bit later on the sunrise safari. But I'm very excited for tonight's sunset safari because he's going to be more relaxed in the dark. So I'm pretty sure he's watching and listening to us at the moment. Raisa says, good morning to the team, all the team, the well-habituated team, lol. Well, yes, we're habituated and hopefully in a couple of months so will he be if he decides to hang around. But I really, really love spending time with an animal like this and just slowly earning their trust and getting them nice and relaxed. It is a very rewarding process. So I have zoned this area, so it is still zoned. So we're not going to put many vehicles in here. Just that when you're habituating an animal, you don't want a vehicle with lots and lots of people on the back who don't mean to, but inadvertently might make a noise that might scare him. So very, very exciting. So Megan's wondering how long will it take for this carcass to be finished. We can't see how much is on the other side, but I'm guessing quite a bit. He's already quite full. So I'd probably say he's going to be here maybe till tomorrow. And this is the best time, obviously, to do this habituation when they've got a kill. It's very difficult to do it when they don't. I'm very, very excited about this, and I hope you guys are too. And fascinating. I always wonder, where's this leopard come from? Definitely not your normal Sabi Sands variety that has grown up with vehicles. I'm guessing Kruger or Manuleti even. But I think Kruger is probably the best bet. So there's no tourist roads in Western Kruger down here. And hopefully we'll be able to get some screenshots or some photographs with some ID features on. And while he's up in the tree, that is a really good time to do it. Safari Dean says, way to go, new guy. Already stashing your meals better than Tingana. Now, there could be multiple reasons for that, actually. Because he's young, and he's probably under quite a bit of pressure from other leopards, a nice kill like that is far more important than to a leopard like Tingana, who was very fat when he caught that impala. And he's quite assured in his position as the sort of leopard king of Juma at the moment. Well, you better be careful. There's new pretenders making their way. And I think he's probably got another, maybe not, probably a year or so before he can really start challenging. But we're going to move out now. And he is lying just behind where that kill is, and sort of just over there behind that thicket. But we're not going to go any closer for now. And I'd rather find him out in the open when we approach, rather than try to force him into the open by driving too close. At least there's a nice spot where we can watch that carcass from quite a bit of distance. And hopefully he will continue to become more comfortable over the next few days. Now, this is by no means a quick and easy process. This is going to take a couple of months if he hangs around. And even when he is slightly relaxed, we're still not going to drive up to him like we do with the other leopards. We're still going to have to be extremely cautious when approaching him. And a lot of that hard work that you can do habituating can be undone in a split second by a bad decision. Just said Tingana is really much the king of the Juma leopards, and Jen's wondering, is he in Tingana's territory? Most definitely at the moment he is. He is sort of on the peripheries between, there's another big male leopard in the north who's not very relaxed, and Tingana. So he's sort of on the boundary between the two. And you do find that these young dispersal males like to sort of sneak around. It's very interesting, his sort of approach to avoiding other leopards will be very similar to Mvula's at the moment. Mvula is now past his prime, and I heard he was in Simbambili yesterday, and he's starting to take some big risks at the moment. So he actually caught a porcupine. Now, leopards who catch porcupines often get severely injured by their quills. So I don't know whether he got any quills stuck in his face or whatnot, but I will try to find out later on today. And the other bad news for him is Tingana's general direction was straight towards where he was. So we saw that kudu hanging up high, and John's wondering how high. I would say about 3-4 meters actually. And so it's quite high up in that Marilla tree. So very little chance of anything else apart from another leopard stealing it. I think we'll give this area probably about a 45 minutes to an hour break before we come back, and we're going to go meander on, see what we can see. Maybe we'll go have a look for the Queen of Juma and see if she's possibly maneuvered back across our southern boundary, and maybe check, see if the Birmingham's decided to do an oop-de-loop and turn around and come back this way. Magical and many others are concerned about Karula's cubs with this new male. Would he be a threat? Most definitely, it's males like them that kill most of the cubs in the Sabi Sands. And of course, it would be very, very sad if that did happen. But again, it is nature, and we're not here to interfere. And this is how leopards control each other's populations. So this is, or leopards control the population of leopards. So if it wasn't for dispersal males killing cubs and even hyenas killing cubs, etc., we'd probably have too many leopards. And there's a reason that leopards have a 70% mortality rate, because if 100% survived, there wouldn't be enough impala to feed them all. But at the moment, her cubs are quite safe. They're quite far away from where he is, but she does move into that area. But he might think twice about going right down into the Mwati just yet. So habituation is a very interesting thing, and it depends a lot on animals and areas. And Megan is wondering, are leopards harder to habituate than other animals, say lions, for example? They are definitely much, much more difficult than lions. Lions are pretty easy. I can take lions that run from a car at 150 meters in 2.5 months, 3 months, and we can sit 10 meters from them. Leopards definitely take a lot longer, mostly because they're harder to find quite often, and also just that their lifestyle is to hide and sneak, whereas a lion is a far more sort of open living animal, and so also much easier to find. They're much more vocal, and also tracks bigger, easier to follow. But leopards are definitely far more difficult to habituate. But fortunately, I've done quite a bit of it over this last couple of, the last 10 or 15 years, so always up for a new challenge, and I do really enjoy working with animals like that. And as I was saying on yesterday's sunset safari, it's not something you get to do too often in the Sapi Sands, that you get a completely unknown, unrelaxed leopard. So it's quite exciting to work with an animal like that. And of course, being a dispersal male, he might not stay around, and he might disappear back off into the Manuleti or Kruger. I mean, there are certain leopards that just don't habituate down. And down in the southern Sabi Sands, we had one of those. Strange enough, he was called the kinky-tailed male. And I think his viewing safe distance was about 70, 80 meters, even though he was born to a very relaxed female, was viewed as a cub, was a relaxed cub, but as he became an adult, he just became quite unpleasant to view. And he had a break in his tail. And he was most famous, though, for if he went closer than 50 meters, he would charge the car and then run off, and then you wouldn't see him again for 3 weeks. I think the strangest charge I ever had by him, I didn't even know he was there. I wasn't even looking for him. I was driving down the road, talking to my guests, la, 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 such a beautiful afternoon, what not, and suddenly, next to me, and I nearly tripped and fell out of the car. Our game drive vehicles there didn't have any doors, and he literally stopped about 3 meters from my leg, and then and he ran off again. I had to stop the car. I did consider having a small snifter of whiskey in the middle of game drive, but fortunately I didn't. I just had a sip of water and was fine and carried on. But both my tracker and I got a huge fright, and he became quite well known for doing that. Welcome back from yesterday, Errol. Errol was a new viewer yesterday, and he's decided to join us again today. So great to have you back, Errol. Errol said he's heard there's more leopards than lions, but they're harder to spot. In Africa in general, yes, there are definitely more leopard than lion, and leopard are more adaptable. And they also don't need as big a sort of open spaces. They can sort of live in the cracks, so to speak. So they're often found on the edges of cities and towns, or even in cities and towns, as in Johannesburg and Durban, Cape Town. There's quite a, in Pietermaritzburg, there's leopard that live right on the edge or in towns. There's a section actually where Connor the Carnivore is from, in Durban, South Africa, called Kloof. And there's a lot of really beautiful sort of indigenous coastal forest in these deep gullies and streams. And the leopards there live quite successfully off cats and dogs. And that's what they feed off. They feed off the domestic pets of the residents of that suburb. But they have been doing so for as long as I can remember. Lions, being that big and not being able to sort of slip between the cracks, they need protected areas like this, and they need a large quantity of large prey to keep them going. So there's about 18,000 to 20,000 lions in the wild left in Africa. And leopards, I can't remember offhand, but I think it's probably closer to 50 or 60,000, maybe even a bit more. I must also remember leopards occur to this day from the southern tip of Cape Town right up to the northern tip of Africa. So from South Africa to Morocco, from desert to rainforest to high mountains. They're very, very adaptable. So, for example, a thing to really show their adaptability is if you think about the leopards here and what they eat. So here we live in a sort of really great environment if you're a leopard, and there's lots of medium to small sized antelope, which is what a leopard likes. So impala, baby kudu, stenbok, duiker.
Morning, what was this? Can I have bird?
Sorry, guys. Morning, Andrew. Nothing yet.
Everything,
right? And so these animals have a sort of a real vast array of food sources available to them. Now, if we look at the Western Cape, so around Cape Town, the Cedarburg Mountains, there are very few sort of large to medium-sized antelope. A lot of them have been locally removed, and if not, it's just not a high antelope density area, those mountains. A couple of rebok, a couple of klipspringers. The average size of a male leopard in the Sabi Sands is probably between 75 and 80 kilograms. And the average size of a female between 35 and even up to 45, 50 kilos for a very big female. Now, your average size of a male leopard in the Western Cape, where they feed off a lot of insects, a lot of rodents, a lot of birds, so not this high protein, high big animal diet. Your average size for a male leopard is 25 to 35 kilograms, so smaller than the average size of a female in the Sabi Sands. And a lot of the female leopards in that area are sort of 12 to 20 kilograms, so absolutely tiny. Now, that's all to do with diet. So we get male leopards here up to 90 kilograms. And I mean, if you got a male leopard of 45 kilograms in the Western Cape, it would be an absolute beastie. And I mean, that's not much bigger than Karula. Karula's probably about 35, 40 kilograms. I'm just trying to see if I can find out what's the population. Just checking into my book of leopards. Now, depending on the area, there is quite a lot of threats that face leopard, but they do seem to be able to survive incredibly well. Now, we've often spoken about where leopards occur. And they have such a massive home range throughout the world. They used to occur all the way through Europe as well. So the dark red, this is not 100% accurate, is their former range. But a lot of this is incorrect. The leopards actually occur a lot of way through South Africa, even though it's red there. But the green is where the dark green is a very stable leopard population. And then also the light green throughout India, Asia, all the way up into Russia and China. So a lot of China and that, they've been completely wiped out. So they've thought they were wiped out in North Africa, but some populations have been found quite recently. The only country, I think, in North Africa that they've been completely wiped out of was Egypt. but they have found populations in Morocco and Tunisia. And yeah, this is, I think, a very outdated map. So this southern Sudan, Ethiopia has actually got a very healthy leopard population in this area here. So they don't naturally occur in that driest of the Sahara, but around the edges they do occur. Now, the Congo Basin leopards, so this whole area here in the rainforests, are actually relatively stable, and just because there's just so little people out there. Okay. But still, that doesn't answer the main question. How many leopards are estimated to be left in Africa? Oh, I'll have to have a proper look. Oh, actually, why don't you guys just check for me so I don't sit there trying to cause a vehicle accident while I try to read through a whole bunch of text while driving. So why don't you guys have a look for me, and if you find out what is the estimated population of leopards left in Africa, I would recommend probably going to the Panthera website. They are probably going to be the best and the most truthful. And a lot of other stuff, there's a lot of doom and gloomers, there's a lot of over-positive, there's a lot of bad science on the internet, let's leave it at that. So I think from my point of view, the most trustworthy would be Panthera. And so if you can find out what that estimate is, and you can send that through to me on questions@wildearth.tv or #SafariLive on Twitter. What is the current estimated leopard population for Africa? So, hi Lewis, he's in Buffalo. Whoa. Land Rover doors, getting used to nearly falling out now. Not nearly the fright I used to get, but Lewis said he didn't realize there were so few lions left in Africa. Some people say their numbers are declining, other people say the numbers are fine. I would not say the numbers are fine, Lewis, that the lion numbers are declining due to loss of habitat quite quickly, and they've been expatriated from most of their original home ranges. Now, in this part of the world, we've got a very good, stable, healthy lion population. I think the last estimate for the Greater Kruger was about 3,500 lions. So we've got a fair few here. So that's a seriously large whack of all the, I mean, if a percentage of there's only 18,000 left, 3,500 is a huge population of that. And then the other big populations of lions would be the northern Botswana, Chobe, Okavango Delta, that whole northern Botswana area into the Kalahari. I think there's also probably about 2,500 there. Actually, one of the most threatened lion populations around is actually the Serengeti Mara group of lions, due to they come into quite a lot of conflict with local villagers. And it's a very contentious subject. I'm not going to delve too deep in it, but there's a lot of human lion conflict in that Masai Mara, specifically worse than Serengeti. But those lions are under quite a bit of threat and under pressure. Megan says that was the funniest leopard impression she's ever seen. Well, thanks, Megan. I do aim to entertain. But speaking of other entertaining creatures, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
hear that you've been having a conversation with Brent about leopards and leopard movements. And just an update on that front, I have found tracks that cross west into Simbambili, so the property on the northwest of Juma. And it's very, very difficult for me to tell if they are for Tingana or if they are for Mvula. They look a little bit too small for Tingana, I think. But it's very hard to tell because it's a main road, so there's traffic up and down constantly. They're not the clearest tracks in the world. They came from Simbambili, they came onto Vuyatela, onto Juma, and then left again. I'm just checking now off-road tracks. So, I think that it could well be Tingana as well, crossing that side. But I want to check Sandy Patch, I want to check around that area, make sure that they haven't, or make sure that we've got the right leopard and that there isn't still one lurking around this area. It's been really interesting watching the movements of Mvula over the last week or so, last 10 days or so, and how out of his normal comfort zone he appears to be. When Brent saw him, he was thinking about hunting a buffalo calf. That was the last time I think we saw him. But he then moved all the way west to Simbambili, which is completely outside of his normal territorial area. And it's because at his age, he's becoming a dispersal male. So essentially doing what he did at the age of about 3-4 years old, when he left his mom and set off to find a territory of his own, or before he was big enough to establish a territory of his own, he was doing what Kunyuma and Quarantine do now, which is duck and dive and move through an area and avoid any large non-related male leopards. And now Mvula's doing essentially just that, except at the opposite end of the scale, so coming towards an older age. And he is ducking and diving and moving in places that he never has, as long as I've been here, and certainly as long as we've known him as the dominant male of this area. And that's because Tingana has pushed right into his territory, Tingana being pushed in turn by the Anderson male further to the west. And it is playing havoc with poor Mvula and where he can go and what he can do. Apparently he was hunting, or we managed to catch a porcupine, something of an Mvula specialty actually. Seems as though he has something of a reputation for hunting porcupine, but that's also a very common prey choice for older leopards. Because porcupine, although they are well defended and prickly characters, are quite slow and relatively easy to catch. It's what you do with them from there that becomes an issue. But he managed to catch a porcupine. He seems to be, from what I've heard, no injuries to report from that kill. Always a little bit of a risky business though. So the lionesses haven't crossed to the west, which is where I thought they were going. Now becomes whether or not they've gone north. And that I think will be our next step to check. James Richards has said that he hopes that Mvula's okay, and that Mvula seems to be playing dangerous games at his age. I just want to have a quick chat with, who's this coming through, Aubrey. I think we're both looking for the same thing. Morning, Orbs. How's it? How are you? Good, thank you. Hi, guys. Which way did those Ngana go last night? I don't see any tracks crossing Triple M. Okay, perfect. Okay, perfect. Thank you. I'm going to cut up Sandy Patch, check Sydney's. All right, thank you. Oh, tracks for my daughter Ingwe cross Simbambili. Okay. Hi. So Orbs is going to try and get hold of Abel, who was the last person in the sighting with the Nkuhumas. See if we can't get an update about which general direction they looked like they were heading in. My suspicion is that they're going to head north to try and relocate the rest of the pride. But that is just pure guesswork as to where they might decide to go. What I can't understand is how they've managed to, from where we last saw them, float away without leaving so much as a trace of a toe or a footprint. Unless maybe they cut back south. That'll be our next step to check. And this road, Sandy Patch Road, up towards Sydney's Dam, is such a productive road in terms of big cats. Including the Nkuhuma Pride. Now, Catherine, as we chat away about them, you were wondering, does the name Nkuhuma have any specific meaning? And yes, it does. It comes from the local name for a brown ivory tree. And if I see a brown ivory tree, Catherine, I'll stop and show you what they look like. A really beautiful tree with thick green foliage, very bright, almost luminous green. And the reason that they have that name is apparently because when they first were found, as a new pride to this area, they were found sleeping under an Nkuhuma tree, under a brown ivory tree. And possibly that became one of their preferred spots to lie up during the day. And lionesses, or lion prides, and male coalitions do have very specific places that they like to go, and as they move through an area, where they like to go and lie down. Which is why we see them fairly regularly in the same place. Here we go. Let me just listen to this for one moment. They did go south. Okay, so those lionesses did go south. We are just going to go check Sydney's Dam anyway. We're currently going north, which would explain why there's not a track or a footprint. We'll check up on Sydney's Dam and then we'll start heading back south again. This is where I had the last tracks for Tingana as well, disappearing into this incredibly dense block. This is a very difficult block to go tracking in. The buffalo love it, the elephants love it, and in fact there's still a couple of elephants around. I've heard them breaking branches while I was following those leopard tracks earlier. So it's a block to be approached with caution, but very often yields incredible results. Perhaps they just crossed Triple M further south from where I checked. That's also a possibility. And Deanna, just in terms of our approach to following animals, most of you know by now that when we hear lions calling in the morning, it instantly gives us a really nice place to start looking. We can guess roughly where the sounds are coming from and move in that direction. But Deanna, I didn't hear any lions calling last night or leopard sawing. Leopard sawing doesn't travel quite as far as a lion's roar, but I didn't hear anything around the house that I live in, and I certainly didn't hear anything this morning. The only lions I heard were calling really far away, far, far to the southeast, so faint that I barely caught the end of that call. No, they weren't calling in our immediate vicinity, but of course lions, particularly lionesses, and particularly two on their own, are not necessarily going to be vocal about it. They're not necessarily going to roar every single night, unless they were trying to find the rest of the pride. I think we'll do a quick stop here. We'll go back down south on Aubrey's Road, pop our head into the hyena den very briefly, and then go check Triple M once again. This Standing by. Copy that. Thank you very much. I thought maybe Aubrey had something here at Sydney's, but it doesn't appear that way. He's just letting me know that the Lions went south along Impala Road, or towards Impala Road. And as I said, lots of elephants about, so it could well be as we were driving down there, particularly in the dark, that we just missed where their tracks came across. Look at the waterbuck. So many youngsters. I'm not sure why they're galloping in circles, but that appears to be the order of the day. Look at all the little ones there at the back. And some zebra as well, making their way down for their morning drink. Oh, trotting back in that direction. So exciting. Morning drink. Oh, nobody really wants to be the first to drink. You never know when a crocodile might be lurking. And there are crocodiles in this dam. The zebra also showing a general nervousness in their approach. Oh, but the little ones are thirsty enough to brave it. There they go. Just to give you an update, Brent's just found female leopard tracks crossing back into Juma. I think that he is going to be following up on those now. But he's also checked for any signs of our lions, and it doesn't seem they've gone in that direction. Lovely. The views from Sydney's dam are so special because it's so nice and open. You can really watch the way that the animals behave and approach from a distance, and gives you a very different perspective on the way in which things work. Nothing like having an elephant herd or a buffalo herd here. Okay, let us go and see if we can't find these lions and where they've gone. Hopefully they've decided to cross onto Arethusa so we can go and view them. I did try to check in with the guides earlier, but I think I was a little bit too far away from any of them to get an answer. Now the Nkuhuma last night, just going back to that conversation we were having about animals calling, if they did kill anything last night, if they managed to kill an impala or anything like that, then they could well still be in the area. And then in particular, they don't want to join, or they don't want to draw attention to themselves. It's just an elephant scuffing his toes. Thought I'd found a drag mark. Was it? Cool. Thank you, Viam. Viam keeping track of all our different tracks out here. Brent. Okay, copy. Just keep an eye out for any inkons or for those in Gala going that way as well. Sorry, hold on one second. I really have to listen to this. I'm just going to hold off giving you the update that I've just got from the Game Dive channel for a moment. I just want to get a clear message. Brent switched onto a different radio channel to listen to it. So we will just wait and see. I want to just make sure that we get the full story of this particular possible, not sighting, but a sighting. It sounds as though it might have been Shadow and her cubs, but I just want to clarify first before I tell you anything more as to where she might be. Let's just get the full details. Sounds as though it's further south, outside of our traverse area. It was a leopard with cubs seen utilizing one of the stormwater drains in the same way that Karula did on the main road. I don't know if it's Shadow or not. Sounds like it might be, but it is much further south, so where our limit goes towards, or the end of Triple M. And we shall just have to wait and see which particular leopard that happens to be. And if she decides to head up in our direction. It's interesting how the leopards have chosen to do that recently, to den in stormwater drains, which obviously make for nice den sites. They're nice and protected. There's not much rain, so there's not much risk of flooding. Don't you find it interesting how they've both chosen, whichever leopard this is and Karula, have both chosen main roads to take their cubs to? I find that fascinating. Now Maggie and the others who want to check up on the hyena den, we're arriving now, but it looks as though all is quiet. The other one was active. Oh, they've moved again. How terribly confusing. This Aubrey's section of dens is so interesting, the way that they move between them. I mean, they've only been at this den site for about a week. And again, they've moved back to a different area. It's the wonderful thing about our live safaris is that you get to observe the behavior of animals. We don't necessarily, or aren't necessarily able to offer an explanation, but it does make for interesting viewing. We know that the hyenas have denned, when they've denned at Philemon's Cutline, Gallagher Shortcut, the Mbubu Road den that James found, they've always been in that den for at least 2 weeks, maybe even three. They were in the Mbubu Road den for a long time. And I'm not sure, I mean, it might be dependent on the cubs' ages. That might play a role. But it seems as though both times that they've moved across to this Aubrey's Road area, they've moved between different termite mounds every couple of days. Let's go up here and check and see. We know our hyena clan relatively well by now. We've spent a great deal of time with them. We know even where their boundary lies with the Arethusa hyena clan. And Lisa was wondering if we knew anything about them, if perhaps we knew where they were denning, for example. And Lisa, they did used to den around Arethusa. They are currently denning on Elephant Plains. And it is an enormous clan. It is a very, very large clan from what I understand. I've seen at one point, this was when we went to go and visit friends at Simbambili, we did a bit of a drive around, and we saw probably somewhere in the region of 17 hyena moving together in one area. So it is a very large clan. Anybody home? Doesn't look that way. All seems to be quiet. Lots of fresh tracks on the ground, so they are here. They're just not out and about. Let's just have a quick look at the, see if we can get that blue wax ball before it disappears. Hopping about in the knobthorn tree. There you go, you can just see the little flashes of blue. And an emerald spotted wood dove at the back as well. Made a brief startling appearance.
And what? Three or two wax balls.
Yes, there's
and a dove.
Two wax balls and a dove. You can see two flashes of blue. I love blue wax balls. I think they're really pretty little birds, unusual looking birds. Not always the easiest birds to get on camera either. Unless they are feeding off seeds on the ground, they tend to be very rapid movers and disappear very quickly. But for new viewers, we always encourage new viewers to keep a bird list. We try and reiterate this every few days. Just keep a bird list and have a look and see if you can't group together all of the different bird species you might see. Nope, all is quiet here. Let's just have one last check. Oh, goodness. Dust in my eyes. Both Linda and Siberia Zumi have offered an explanation for why it might be that the hyenas move away from the den sites more quickly. And that is that maybe it will make it harder for the predators or other predators to find them. It's an entirely valid argument. And I mean, we know that one of the reasons why hyenas move hyena dens or different to different den sites is because the smell builds up and makes it more and more apparent. But that's more because it's unhygienic than anything else. But yes, the stronger smelling the den is, the more likely it's going to be to attract the attention of predators. That being said, I mean, with the Mvubu Road den, I was fairly certain that the lionesses, the leopards of that area, all knew where that den site was. And in fact, I think it was one of the reasons why Karula chose to den further south than she usually does with her cubs, just to keep them out of harm's way. So I'm not sure about that argument. I definitely am not discounting it. But you understand my logic that I think predators know regardless. I mean, if we can smell a hyena den within a couple of days of use, then predators definitely can. My suggestion as to why this might be, it's only a theory. I think that the hyenas, but I mean, this is such a stretch. Maybe it's too much of a stretch. Personally, I think hyenas have preferences for den sites at different ages for the cubs. When I first arrived here, June was still a tiny little cub. He'd only just started coming out of the den. They were at Philemon's cut line. They then moved to Gallagher Shortcut. And it was only when the cubs were a little bit older that they moved them to the Aubrey's Road den. And because they were a little bit older, their movements away from the den site is more adventurous. And it kind of makes sense in my head. You're welcome to contradict me completely if you want to. It's a total theory. But it makes sense that they choose the Aubrey's Road den site because there's so many of these termite mounds that are appropriate places for the cubs to be able to move between. Maybe it's just the cubs get adventurous when they're at the age that the mothers bring them to the Aubrey's Road den. I mean, it's a bit of a stretch. Maybe I'm pushing too hard for an explanation to something that isn't there. Well done, Viam. I'm not even sure which bird that was. It moved off so fast. Right, I'm going back to the last position of the lion tracks and where Abel saw them crossing south. Let's find out what Brent's plans are.
We're just checking very, very carefully to see where those lines might have crossed, whether they've crossed into Arethusa or whether they crossed into Sibambili. So if they've crossed into Arethusa, I'm sure Jamie will continue to follow them. And I'm just biding my time, so to speak, before we head back to the jumpy one. I'm hoping he will move up into the tree to start feeding at some point. I'm not a relaxed male. He might just pop down the tree when we go up there, so it might be better on the sunset safari. But till then, we're just gonna keep checking, help Jamie track in this area. And just actually find out from her exactly where those tracks were said to have crossed. Jamie.
35.
Can you confirm exactly where those tracks are supposed to have crossed south on Triple M?
Brent, no,
Copy, me neither. I've got no tracks crossing across Triple M. Maybe they're still in that block between Zoe's and Triple M. Yeah. Yeah. Copy, good idea. Just keep a lookout for those leopard tracks as well around Zoe's. Okay, so I can't find any proof of these lions coming down here, but I'm going to double check again. It always pays to be doubly cautious, especially on a busy road like this. Nope, nothing down there. Always, as I said, pays to double check. Anna-Marie saying that they're not 100% sure on the leopard population, but some people think there's as few as 3,000 left in South Africa. I'm not so sure about that one, Anna-Marie. I think there's probably a few more, but what you need to look at is the meta population. So if you start looking at individual countries, it becomes quite complicated to work out. So you want to be looking at least Southern Africa, and that'll give you a much better idea. Because a lot of those leopard populations are cross-border populations, especially in South Africa. We've got a very healthy cross-border Mozambique-Zimbabwe population, a healthy Botswana cross-border population, and a healthy Namibia cross-border population. So I think the estimate for Kruger is about 2,000 or so. So 3,000 for the whole of South Africa is a little bit low. There we go, and that wonderful thing about the leopard being able to slip through the cracks, and three different groups say the leopard population is unknown in the wild. And so basically, the best way to do it is you work on the protected areas that have healthy leopard populations, and you work on it, you go above average, so you always try to be as pessimistic as possible with these type of things. So if we take Let's just take the whole Kruger, which is 1.9 million hectares. Now, that's not including the private reserves, just Kruger National Park. And through the various habitats, you're probably looking, on average, at somewhere between 1,500 and 2,000 hectares per leopard. Now that's, of course, mixing male and female, which is, we're just doing some general stuff here. We're not going too specific. So let's call it 2,000. It's a nice round number to work out with. An average of 2,000 in 1.9 million hectares. Let's actually be a little bit more, because we do have some of those dry areas where there's not a lot of leopard at all. Their territories would probably be 5,000 hectares. So let's call an average of about 3,500 hectares for interest's sakes. Now, of course, this is by no means pure science. We're just doing a bit of educated guessing at the moment. And I need to find a calculator. Calculator. I'm definitely not doing those numbers in my head. Okay. I'm struggling to find a calculator here. Remember, technology sometimes confuses me. Don't forget to look for the lion tracks while I'm fiddling, Dave.
Oh, yes.
I'm sure these things used to have calculators on them. So there we go, that's probably a much better idea. Final control is going to calculate for me. But let's take an average of 3,500, or even, let's be even more pessimistic, let's call it 4,000 hectares. So that's averaging between male and female territory sizes and different types of habitat. Because, of course, on the big rivers, the territories are smaller, and away from the big rivers, they're bigger. So let's take 4,000, so let's 1.9 million divided by 4,000. See what that comes up with. No, I haven't. So we take an average, there we go, of about 4,000 hectares. Now that's covering both male and females. And of course, if we had to do it properly, we would separate the male territories from the female territories, and the males would be bigger, so there'd be less males. But let's just be very much generalists now. We're having a nice discussion rather than trying to prove a scientific argument. So that gives us a number of 475, and I said we're being very pessimistic. So I'm pretty sure there's more than 475 leopards in the Kruger. I think there's probably close on, I mean, let's just think about the leopards we know about in the northern Sabi sites. So that's being very pessimistic. I'm guessing there's probably about 1,500 to 2,000 leopards in the greater Kruger, just based on what I've seen and the type of habitat we go through. So if we take the northern Sabi sands, which is, we've got 1,000, 3,000, 4, 5, about 9,000 hectares on this that side, and then we've got probably another 7 or 8 that side. So about 15, it's closer to 20,000 hectares in the northern Sabi sands. And let's just go on the leopards we know. So not any of these leopards that might be or might not be, that we know that definitely hold territory in the northern Sabi sands. And those are also ones that are outside of our traverse area. So we have, of course, number one on everyone's list, Queen Karula, who's very much still here. And we'll go with her two daughters next, Shadow and Tundi. And after Shadow and Tundi, stick with the females. In Kanunini, it's around 4. I think that. Salaheshe, 5. What's her name now? She's Kwatile's daughter, but K something. But anyway, because we're not even going to count Cortilla in case she actually has passed to the next realm. So there's her daughter. So we're now on 6. Salehesha's cub is also a female. That's 7. And then there's Shluva. That's 8. And there's that Manuleti female in Buffelshoek. That's 9. And then I've forgotten the name of the other one. Oh, what's her name? She's down on the Londo's boundary in Elephant Plains. That's 10. And then there's another one on the Mala Mala boundary with Hoffman's. So that's 11. That's 11 females. Now let's go on to the males. There's Mr. Anderson. There's Tingana. There's Mvula. There's Shivambalan. And there's this guy, because we're seeing him regularly. Or not regularly, but we have been seeing him for the last while, so the unknown, it's 5. And then Quarantine and Kanuma are still around, that's 6, that's 7. And then there's this new male that's being seen to the west of us that's moved up from Malamala called Rockdrift, so that's 8. So what are we, that's 19 leopards in 20,000 hectares. So final control, please could you do 20,000 divided by 19. Here we go, here's some zebra barras. There we go, nice little herd of zebras have moved out to the open area near Sydney's waterhole. Now, we were seeing a lot of zebra, now we're not seeing so many. Now, because of the rain, they've dispersed. And so there's more grazing, so they don't, and more water, so they don't all have to be focused in an area. So apparently 20,000 divided by 19. I think I should have done that the other way around. I think it's 19 divided by 20,000 to get the leopards per hectares for this area. But as I said, this maths is not my strong point. But we will figure that out. So there we go, it's 0.095 leopards per hectare. So that's nearly a, no, I think I'm confusing myself here. So just that, we're gonna leave these zebras, we're gonna start heading back towards that unrelaxed male. While we do that, Jamie's got some interesting insects to show you, and I'm gonna try to figure out in my head what crazy mathematics I've been trying to do.
I've just been thinking about the mathematics of termite mound building and all the hundreds of thousands of workers, if they lay down 5 grains of sand per minute, what kind of productivity will come from that. And just have a look at these termites. They've all started slowing down now. Just when we first got here, it was a flurry of activity. Unfortunately, they really have picked the silliest spot to start building up a termite mound. I'm not sure if they are part of the same colony that has built up a giant termite mound to the right of us. I'm actually starting to think they might be a different species. They almost look like they might be snouted termites. But here they go. You can see how much work they've done overnight. All of that fresh dark mud, that's been done since last night and early this morning. Because it's cool and cloudy, they are quite happy to work away at building it. And I'll just give you a sense of scale, just to show you just how productive they have been with their day. They've built all along here. There's some still building right in the middle here. And then if I come across, they're starting around here as well. And this is just to give you an idea or a sense of scale. This is how much they've constructed. And a lot of these look like they are soldiers as well. This is not the common harvester termite that we usually see. Try it. aggressive. I'm trying to get one to grab this blade of grass. They've got very, very powerful mandibles. And they readily bite and attack and hold on, like this one is doing. I prefer not to do this with my finger. Just look how strong those jaws are. Incredible. Holding up his whole body weight on that blade of grass. Can I pop him back now? I just prefer it. I know James has done this several times with his finger. I prefer not to, actually. I'm quite happy to not let the termites bite me. There you go, buddy. Back to your friends. You can release that attacking grass blade that he grabbed. You can see how strong those jaws are. It's interesting to see soldiers so busy with the construction of part of the termite mound. And that's what they seem to be doing. They really seem to be building, which is interesting. Usually you've got that very clear division. And let me see if I can't find you a picture of what I mean. Let's use this as an example. It's not necessarily what we're looking at, but you've got a very clear division between the workers, the slightly smaller pale ones, and then the soldiers with the larger heads and the more fierce mandibles. I think the individuals, initially I thought we were looking at snouted harvester termites, but I don't think so anymore. I think maybe we are just looking at common all-garden fungus-growing termites. So the ones that farm fungus in their termite mounds. We've spoken a lot about them. And the reason that they build these vent-like structures is in order to keep the temperature constant for the fungus to grow. And they basically form a very, very close relationship with a fungus known as tomatomyces that digests. They use the fungus to digest the parts of the plant material that they can't, but at the same time they farm that fungus, keep it healthy, keep it at the right temperature that's optimum for its growth, which is around between 32 to 37 degrees centigrade, so in the 90s Fahrenheit. Unfortunately, they have definitely put themselves in the wrong place. Let me just sort out what's happening with my mic. Might have hooked as I got out of the car. Yep. On for a bit of a walk. Here we go. There we go. Right, we're going to drive my tires around both of them, although unfortunately, I think that choice of venue for a termite mound is not the most appropriate. I mean, I've driven around them, but chances are a little bit later when all of those termites have gone back underground, when the sun gets too hot, chances are those termite mounds are going to be driven over at some point by somebody using this road. Definitely not the most intelligent spot to put a termite mound. Shame. All of their hard night's work. I know that we had a question about elephant tracks, and I am keeping an eye out. We have got some nice ones here. Book Diva, you wanted to know what an elephant track looks like. I'm just trying to find, I wish the sun would come out just a little bit to make it clearer. Oh, and let's try and find a spot where the zebras haven't walked all over the elephant track. Let's try and find you a nice clear one, Book Diva. And I'll also be able to jump out and just give you a perspective of just how large an elephant track really is and really can be. There's lots of young bulls around at the moment. We had an incredible sighting with some of them on quarantine yesterday, quarantine clearings. Just spending time with them, very peaceful sighting. But it is interesting just how many young bulls have decided to move in around Juma at the moment. And I'm sure there's a good chance that either Brent or myself, sorry, just listening, Game Drive comms. Oh, okay, not relevant to us. But yes, there's lots. We could well see one of these young elephants at some point. Come on, son. Make a little bit of an attempt here. It'll make looking at these tracks a lot easier. So you need... Whenever we drive about in this cloudy weather, we have to check even more carefully than we usually do for tracks, because the light doesn't really strike them at the right angle. So we've got elephant tracks here for Book Diva. Believe it or not, that is an elephant track. And what I'm going to do to make things easier is I'm actually going to hop out and I'll show you, I'll draw the outline for you so that you get a better idea of what it is you're looking at and a sense of scale. So within elephant tracks themselves, you don't see any, you don't really see the toes all that clearly, although elephants do have toes. You just see a round dinner size or dinner plate sized flattened part with all of the wrinkles showing through. And in fact, the sun's coming out now nicely.
This one would might be.
This one is going to be the best. So there we have, I don't want to stand with my shadow over it. This is an elephant track. Now he's walking relatively slowly. His back track is falling on top of his front track. And all of these really fine lines are the wrinkles in his feet. But to make it easier for you, I'm actually going to outline his track. That is his front foot. And this is his back foot. You can see where with most animals, most of the weight falls on the front half of their body. So the tracks in front tend to be bigger and rounder than the ones at the back. So his front foot has fallen here, his back foot falls on top of it. And very conveniently with elephant tracks, their back tracks almost make an arrow pointing in the direction that they're going. So this elephant is going that way. And if you're interested, just from the way his feet have fallen, oh, and you can also have a look at the length of his stride. This is his right side, and this is his left side. Let me go back a little bit so you can see. So the distance between his left and the next left, so left here, right here, left here. Long strides, so even walking slowly, they cover an enormous amount of distance in just with that slow loping walk. Okay, so Book Diva, that's what an elephant track looks like. We're not going to try and track him, however, because elephants can cover tremendous distances in one go. And these tracks are from sometime last night. They have been walked over by other animals like zebra. Cool, so you sort of roughly get the idea. Sometimes we get much nicer, clearer examples with the sun, when the sun is cooperating. Where on earth have these lions gone? Now, Linda, just chatting about the termite mounds that are being built up in the road, you were wondering if we will protect them from being disturbed. And the answer is unfortunately no. There's a very good conservation reason behind that. First of all, once those termites have gone back underground as the day gets hotter, and when that termite mound does get ridden over by a car, they won't go back and then build in the same place. They will start building elsewhere. Now, the only thing that we could do to save them is to redirect the road around them. And that actually does far more ecological damage than the partial destruction of a little bit. And as you know, most of a termite mound is underground anyway. So that's just a little vent system that unfortunately has chosen the wrong place to be. Roads do have an impact, and they, of course, are totally necessary, but they do have an impact on the environment. And creating an extra loop around is going to create that extra point of compression of the soil. And that can go many, many layers deep if that road is used regularly. and it will create an extra area for water to flow down, because there's no grass or, I mean, apart from a couple of blades in the middle of the road, there's no grass or trees or anything to stop water flow down roads, which is one of the reasons why we have those speed bumps, those bolsters. They're not for speed, they are for stopping the flow of water and redirecting it into the soil where it belongs, rather than having the road draw out the underground water that should be flowing through an area. So although it seems quite cruel to not just casually drive around the termites, it's not really possible, and it actually ultimately will do more ecological damage than just mowing down that one little bit. But you'll find that what we'll do is we'll wait until it's hot and the termites have gone underground, so that we don't actually then needlessly kill any of them in that process. And that termite mound, once it does get hot, those termites will be completely gone from that particular section above the ground. That's very interesting. A white-backed vulture. Well done, Viam. I wonder what he is doing here, and if there's any particular reason. Quite possibly not. He might just have been roosting. He was sitting. I know we've spoken about how they prefer to be in trees without leaves, and that's exactly where he was sitting up in the dead tree that's straight into the sun. So he was just basking and warming up, and maybe he just settled there for the night. If we were seeing more vultures, possibly different species, and maybe even sitting in trees with leaves, we could start to wonder if the Nkuhumas aren't hiding a kill somewhere from us. I have a track quiz for you, and I just need to figure out how I'm going to ask it. And it should be, it's a difficult one, but there is a very clear answer. There's no other options. Can we have a look at the bird tracks in the middle of that elephant track in the sun there? Thank you very much. Okay, let's see if anybody can tell me which bird has walked along through this elephant track. And I will give you one hint. Each track is toe to heel. So each track falls then straight in front of the other, toe to heel. Let's see how many of you can figure out which particular bird species this is. I know that, I think it was Darlene who asked about whether or not we can tell individual species of birds from their tracks. Let's see if any of you can figure out which bird this might be. Walking on the ground, has a back toe, and is walking on the road. Tracks falling like this. See if any of you can get that. Send that through to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. In the meantime, let's find out how Brent's search for that mystery leopard is going.
So someone asked about Mr. Ghost Leopard's track, and there it is. This is from where he's departed and gone for a drink. It was here when you came in this morning, and you can see it's quite a, it's a big male track. I mean, there's a car tire there, that's width there. So it's a big male track, as big as an Imvula track or a Tingana track, although often with leopards, their feet grow faster than the rest of them. He's going to be quite a nice male when he's finished growing. Now, we're going to be sneaking in again. So we're still quite far away from where he is, but we wanted you to join us in case he is in the tree. He might jump down the tree if he is. So we just want to go very slowly in there to have a look. This area is still zoned to one vehicle only. And I have spoken nicely to other guys, and they've agreed to just stay away for now. And we're going to just work slowly on habituating. Now, it's much easier for us to habituate because there's only Dangerous Dave and myself. So there's not 10 people on a vehicle who, of course not on purpose, but inadvertently might move too quickly or make a funny noise that might disturb him. So we're going to go very, very slowly in here. So we can see that marula tree in the distance there. The kill's just off to there. So I'm coming in speaking, so he knows we're coming. We're not coming in quietly and sneakily, but I am coming in very slowly. So the opposite to going after wild dogs. We're following his tracks when we first came in this morning. Initially, the kill was by that second marula down the road there, just off to the left. And we noticed these tracks veered off a little bit earlier. And so that's to where he's moved that kudu carcass. I'm gonna try and get, even if it isn't the best visual, from quite far away before we even attempt to try see where we can see it, just if we can see the tree that carcass is in. Beautiful light coming through. So Genevieve's wondering how long it takes to assess the personality of each individual leopard when you start habituating. Genevieve, it's so difficult to say that, and each individual leopard's different. And sometimes you can never succeed in the habituation process. Other times it happens much quicker than you think it's going to. So I was already incredibly pleasantly surprised with the progress we managed to show just yesterday afternoon. Marula was the next one. Just there, zoom in, it's that marula. So he's, I don't think he's up in the tree. Have you got a visual there, Dave? Okay, let's roll forward a bit. There we go. So there's the carcass. So he's not up in the tree. And as I said, we are going to keep our distance for now. Especially during the day, he's not going to be nearly as relaxed as in the dark. I'm just going to go forward again. And I'm just going to keep driving past. We might spot him on the ground, but if we don't, I'm definitely not going to drive off-road in this bright sunlight towards him. Unfortunately, I don't think we're going to get it. We might not get a visual apart from the one Dave and I briefly had this morning, which wasn't a very good one, on this sunrise safari. We might get a good chance on the sunset safari, but I don't want to undo any of the good work we did last night. But the really great thing is that it is in a tree, so we can stay after dark now. Okay, well, I think we've done enough and just a nice little slow drive-by this morning. We're gonna leave the area. Now, I'm not gonna come back here again. I think twice is enough for one morning. So we'll head off and see what else we can find. So before we get on to Lucy from Indiana's question, we're just going to quickly close off that very confusing mathematical stuff that was going on a little bit earlier. So we did a few calculations. It was a bit easier doing them myself. I understood what I was doing. So this is a very good area to say as an average area, because it's not the best leopard territory, but it's not the worst. It's sort of somewhere in the middle. And I completely forgot that we have 6 cubs at the moment as well, that we know about. So there's obviously Shadows 2, Karulas 2, and Kanini's 2. So if we take 70% of those are going to die, which is the average mortality rate in the Sabi Sands, it leaves us with 2 of those 6 surviving. So that takes us from 19 to 21. And with 21 leopards and 20,000 hectares, it's an average of about a single leopard per 952 hectares. And if we take that, this is a very good average area, so and we take that and we put that through to the 1.9 million hectares of Kruger, it works out to 1,195 leopards. So, and that's on a very average sort of, very, very average. Of course, it could be a little bit more, it could be a little bit less. We didn't include the private reserves, we just try to keep it to the greater Kruger, just the Kruger National Park. And so, now I said, this is no by means exact science, but it can give us a sort of a rough general idea of how many leopards are in this area. And you probably find this is the largest, not probably, it is the largest leopard population in South Africa would be the Kruger and its surrounds. So Lucy was wondering, do young male leopards have respect for their elders, or do they just fight them? Well, Lucy, he would definitely have quite a lot of respect for any male bigger than him. Females, probably not. So he'll probably fight, try steal kills from the females if he got the opportunity, kill their cubs. But a big male like Tingana, judging from his size, I think he would have a healthy respect for. Now, Mvula, that's an interesting one. He might actually have a go at Mvula, especially because Mvula's condition isn't quite what it once was. And he is an older male, so he might fight an Mvula type character, but I don't think he would risk Tingana just yet. So while we continue to see what else we can find on this gorgeous late summer's morning, Jamie has got an avian predator to show you.
And on this peculiar misty morning, one of our raptor species is making short work, or taking advantage at least, of the current explosion in population of insects and reptiles that we've been experiencing. He's got something very difficult to see straight into the sun, what it's got, but it's definitely feeding on something. It's got something in its claws. Is attempting to balance on a very spindly dead branch at the same time and feed. I'm struggling in this particular light to see exactly what it is. My first thought was with that square tail was a Wahlberg's, but I think it's a little bit small. Could be a goshawk, but with its posture bent over like that and straight into the sun, it is very tricky to tell. I think it's that dark chanting goshawk. Feathers not all the way down to the legs, and it looks the right sort of color in this very gray light. I think I can see flashes of orange on the feet. There you go, you can see it feeding clearly now. Could even be the same goshawk that Brent saw attacking that snake a couple of days ago. It's the right sort of area. We're in very close to where Brent had that sighting. Beautiful, beautiful light. Misty and cloudy. Strange weather. Transitional weather is what it feels like. You can feel the change in the air. And I'm sure all the animals can as well. making the most of whatever opportunity presents itself, like our, what I think is a goshawk, sort of looking straight into the sun, getting as much food as they can in preparation for the relatively hard months ahead. I'm heading across to Treehouse Dam in the hope that maybe I've missed the lion's tracks popping out and coming south. Both Brent and myself have checked Triple M. They don't seem to have crossed there. We'll just check around the waterholes, see if they haven't decided to go down for a drink. The only other alternative, of course, is that the elephants have walked over where their tracks have crossed, which is entirely possible. There's been lots of elephant activity throughout the night. Apparently we're getting a couple of answers coming through on the subject of tracking for the track quiz. One of them is correct. One of them I will absolutely accept. Franklin's and guinea fowl. Maybe what I should actually have done, to be completely fair to you, was to get out and show you the exact size of that track. The track is about the size of, about half the size of my thumb. Now, a Franklin and a guinea fowl, a Franklin's tracks is about 6 centimeters long. So what is that? That's about 2 inches in length. And without a back toe, a guinea fowl is even longer than that, close to 10 centimeters. So close to just over 3 inches. So even longer, again, without a back toe. And I specifically mentioned the back toe in that way. So the bird that we're looking at is a passerine of some kind. It's got 3 toes in the front and 1 at the back. Now that could include hornbills, but a hornbill has a very, very special adaptation. It has got a slight fusion between its second and its third toe. And what that does is it creates a banana shape to the hornbill's tracks. They curve inwards. But we are, in fact, looking at the answer to our track quiz, or almost at the answer to our track quiz. They're not walking on the road, but they are walking on the ground. So well done, Siberia Zumi. You suggested mourning dove. Judging by the size of it, it was not actually the Cape turtle doves that we were looking at, although I would have accepted that as an answer just because of the sense of scale. My suggestion was actually it was an emerald spotted wood dove, which is very similar to the size of a mourning dove's track. It's just more likely because we see more of them on the roads, and emerald-spotted wood doves in particular like to cruise along these roads. The most important aspect of a dove's tracks, and unfortunately, for some bizarre reason, I don't have my tracking book with me, but when doves walk, you've got 3 very distinct toes spread out, slightly curved inwards towards the middle track, and what you get is you get the 1 foot falling with the other in, or just on right next to the other one. So they walk like this, and when you describe a pigeon-toed, so somebody walking with their tracks facing slightly inwards, that's what you refer to, and that's where it comes from, the way that doves and pigeons walk, slightly curving inwards, and they make these beautiful little tracks on the road. The only other bird you might confuse it with is a starling, but the difference is starlings have much longer legs, and they don't really walk, they run along the road, and we'll stop and we'll have a look at one when we do see one running. And they, so the separation between the tracks is quite distinct. There's a clear stride length. Whereas with doves, they basically do that. So well done to Siberia Zumi. The hoopoe answer was a good one. It was a good suggestion. But again, same as the starling, you do get that slight extension away from the tracks. Also, you very seldom see hoopoes walking regularly on a road. The reason behind that is roads, as we spoke about before, they're compressed. So they're very hard by the constant vehicle traffic. And there's not much insect life happening within that layer, that top layer of soil. There will be further down underneath it, but there's not much for them to collect. And so the probing beak of the hoopoe doesn't, it's not really suited for trying to dig into the road. I can actually hear the mourning dove, the emerald spotted wood dove. It's meant to be saying, I'm sad, 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 sad. And all the while, we're being very closely observed. There's a tiny little head. Oh, no, there was a tiny little head. That tiny little head is now ducked down behind the grass. There's another one a little bit further to the left of that, sticking out of the burrow. Hello. Are you listening to Tracking Lessons, Dwarf Mongoose? Do you think you can tell the difference now between a starling and a dove? Yes. Definitely, I'm sure they were fascinated by that conversation. Definitely one of my favorite animals. It seems as though our dwarf mongoose are playing a little bit shy at the moment. And I just want to say, while we have the opportunity, a good morning to a new viewer, Rich. Rich is watching on YouTube and saying that he's just joined the live stream and is really enjoying it and would like to know who's taking him out on safari. Rich, my name is Jamie, and behind me I have Viam. Viam operates the camera, and without our wonderful cameraman, we would definitely not be able to bring you these incredible live safaris. We've actually got two vehicles out this morning. The other vehicle has Brent presenting or driving and guiding, and Dave sitting on the back operating the camera. We also have two lovely ladies in a control room watching both of us and what we do, and they make a decision. Ow, there's a branch there. They make a decision about which vehicle to go to and how to switch between the different sightings that we have. And Rich, we're coming to you live from South Africa. We're in a place called Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Sabi Sands in the Greater Kruger National Park area. So right up in the northeastern corner, or close to the northeastern corner of South Africa. And we welcome you on board, and we would love to hear the questions and the comments that you would like to make. Feel free to ask away about what animals you could see out here, what you would like to see. And Jerry, in final control, will send them through to me via an earpiece, and we'll be able to answer them straight away. What you are seeing on your screen is happening in real life. First thing in the morning in South Africa. Such an amazing concept. I've been working here for a long time, or a relatively long time now, and it's still, when I stop to think about it, and whenever we chat to new viewers, I still absolutely am amazed by this concept. So welcome, Rich, to Safari Live, brought to you by the Wild Earth team. And there's a great deal more going on behind the scenes. At the moment, Rich, we are looking for two lionesses that we saw yesterday afternoon. And bear in mind, of course, we go out twice a day, every day. Yesterday afternoon or yesterday evening, we ended off with two lionesses walking off into the dark, thinking about, somewhat lazily, admittedly, but thinking about hunting impala. And I've been looking for them all morning. I don't know where they've gone, though. They seem to have flown away. But I hope, Rich, that you jumped on board when Brent was showing everybody across the world a new and very exciting leopard that has only just moved into this area and has been exceptionally nervous, and Brent doing a really, really amazing job, and it's not easy to do, of slowly getting him more and more used to the idea of vehicles moving about him and getting him used to the idea that it's not a threat at all. I want to stop because we're looking for the Nkuhuma lionesses, and I did get asked about the meaning behind the name Nkuhuma. And this is the one good example that I know of. So we'll just stop here briefly on our way to Treehouse Dam at this beautiful tree. Remember how I said it's got a thick crown of vivid green leaves? And quite a tall, upward-reaching tree. This is an Nkuhuma tree, or as its name in English, a brown ivory. Catherine, I do think that was you who asked. Catherine asked about the name Nkuhuma. They were named because they were enjoyed lying beneath the shade of this spectacular tree. I don't know if it was this tree in particular. Maybe it's within the Nkuhuma's range, but I don't think so. Either way, this is the tree that gives one of our favorite lion prides their name. very, very fissured bark, quite textured and almost grey-brown in colour. Beautiful tree, and when my brain decides to kick into gear, I will be able to give you the Latin name. For some reason, it's the one that Brent always tests me on. It's the one that I always get wrong. You know how when you learn something, there's always that one thing that for some reason just won't settle in your head. Discolor. Okay, I'll think as we drive, rather than stop, rather than you sitting watching me desperately rack my brains trying to remember this. It'll come. It will come. You know, and I can tell you straight off the bat the Latin name of a black mamba. There we go. Burkinia. Burkinia bicolor, not discolor, bicolor. Burkinia. There's also a tree known as a red ivory, and that is a Burkinia mogami. Slightly different. Definitely one of the most attractive looking trees. Not on my top five though. I have a very set top five list of beautiful trees that I love to look at. And as lovely as the ivory tree is, it just doesn't quite make the cut for me. We've spoken before on this road about favorite bird calls. I wonder what your favorite trees are out there. I'm just having a giggle at Siberia Zumi's comment, since we've been discussing tracks and tracking on a relatively quiet morning in the African bush, from my side at least. Siberia Zumi has suggested that perhaps I should track down and find an elephant shrew. You can actually track them, funnily enough. I mean, we laugh about it, but when you get to know an area well enough, you'll start to see the little trails that they make. They like to have little pathways, little highways that move under bushes. And if I ever see a good example, I will show you. The elephant shrew is one of the small five, a little rodent with an extended proboscis that gives it its name, like an elephant's trunk. You don't see them all that often. All right, back to what I was chatting about my favorite trees. I'll start to give you my top five. I'll try and give you my top five list of trees that I really love to look at. Leadwood, this is in no particular order though, just because I find that impossible. Leadwood, fever tree, nyala tree, what was I going to say? Sorry, I got distracted. Leadwood, what did I just say? Leadwood, fever tree, jackalberry, I've been totally distracted by tracks on the ground, sorry. Totally distracted. Right, let's try that again. The leadwood, the fever tree, the nyala tree, the jackalberry, and my fifth and final tree is the Lofalt cluster fig, or the sycamore fig. Those to me are the trees that when I look at, sort of bring me the most incredible feeling of peace and tranquility. I wonder, some of you have been watching long enough now that I think you must have developed a sense. I'm not expecting you to name nyala trees, nyala berries. You don't get them here. I haven't seen any large ones on Juma. We might have to cut that one off your possibility list, unless you've been to South Africa and you've traveled the great river systems in Kruger and you've seen these giant, beautiful trees with enormous crowns, and they're such perfect leopard trees. I've had the most incredible leopard sightings on these. And when I say giant, I mean with trunks the size of this termite mound kind of giant. They can be absolutely enormous. Anna Marie has said her favorite tree, as we go past my nyala tree sized termite mound. Anna Marie has said that her favorite tree is the most common tree, the marula tree. Absolutely nothing wrong with that. Marula trees are incredibly beautiful. The leopards love them. Here we go, perfect example. This is a little one. but we've got some giant specimens on quarantine. Oh, Teresa's listed a tree that I should have thought of, and my only excuse is going to be that it's technically not a tree. It's more of a succulent, very strange thing. Teresa has said a baobab, and now that she's mentioned that, I almost feel as though that should go on my list. Can I make a top six list of trees?
You can do a top seven, but not a top six.
Okay, and VM says I can only do a top seven, not a top six. All right, well, we'll throw baobab onto that list, and I'll give the seventh a good thought. The baobabs.
My marula tree is only like 20 centimeters long.
Your marula tree?
Mm.
Oh, VM's planted a marula tree.
And I got from when the show started 2 years back.
That's awesome. So VM's growing a marula tree that he's been growing for since the show started, or since he joined Wild Earth 2 years back. And it's now, what, 20 centimeters, you said? 20 centimeters in height, which is just over 6 inches. Oh, it's growing. Amazing. Just think about those enormous marula trees that we see. If VM's has grown 20 centimeters in the last 2 years, just imagine how long it's taken those marula trees to grow to the age and to the size that they have. And what wonderful transitions they must have seen in an area like this. How many leopards they have sheltered in their branches, and leopard kills they have sheltered in their branches. That's what I really love about trees. Marcel has said that hers is a Douglas pine tree. And you know, I've just had a revelation while we've been driving along and talking about this. I've suddenly realized why trees fascinate me personally, and everybody has their different area of fascination. Why trees fascinate me far more so than, for example, flowers. And I think it's the longevity of a tree species. I think it's the time and the effort that's been put into its growth and the years that it's taken to reach the size that they do, and what they can tell you about the environment that you are living in, from anything from the soil types to what animal you're going to find here. It's such a pity we don't get the mapani trees in this area. Mapanis with their beautiful butterfly-shaped leaves, perfectly symmetrical, divided leaves. That's true. VM's got a good point. It's maybe a good thing that we don't have mapani trees in this area. And to an extent, he's absolutely right. Mapani trees can be a very invasive species. They're not invasive in the sense that they are not indigenous. They are indigenous, but they are bush encroachers, or they can be bush encroachers. And they're actually capable of secreting substances in the soils that stop other plant life from growing, stop other trees from growing, which is why you get those enormous mapani tree forests almost in the central Kruger, which are incredible to drive through and teeming with elephant life and not much else hiding around there. We've also got hippo tracks going down to Treehouse. Could we see a hippo in Treehouse Dam, or was it just passing through last night? James Richards has said that he loves any tree that has a leopard draped across its branches. Fair enough. Good answer. I think VM probably feels the same way.
Leopard fruit.
And Heather, who's watching all the way in Alaska. Now, this is the part of the discussion that I love, because now I'm learning about different trees from your side of the world. And Heather has said that she loves aspen trees, which are, in fact, one of the largest living organisms on Earth. And it's not just limited to the single tree that you see. And now, Heather, what you've done is you've really sparked an interest in me to go and have a look at that, because I find that absolutely fascinating. In my head, I'm picturing the way that fungus works, and the fact that the mushroom that you see pops up is just one tiny part of a whole. I didn't think we were going to see a hippo in this dam, and we're definitely not going to. It's a little bit too shallow. I'm just going to stop for 1 second so I can take off my jacket because this weather has been so bizarre. I am very much enjoying this conversation about the different trees. Rich, our new viewer, is watching in California and says, being from California, he loves the palm trees that they get there. That's also a really good answer. I must admit, I've never been to the States, so I've only ever seen pictures of the different areas and maybe different documentaries, but I always think that those redwood trees, those enormous giant creatures that are thousands of years old, the redwoods I find fascinating, and I think if I ever did take a trip to the States, let's just imagine in my world that the exchange rate is not quite as brutal as it is right now between the South African rand and the US dollar. And I think that it would be one stop on my list that I would most definitely be making. But I mean, there's so much to see. Megan, who's watching, is commenting on Twitter. Megan is saying that although it's not in Africa, she loves the weeping willows of the world. And so do I, Megan. I also think those are extraordinary. We've got quite a few introduced around the Highveld area, which is where I'm from. And maple trees, sorry, Megan, maple trees as well was one of the ones that you suggested. I've been following these elephant tracks for ages. We've got to find an elephant at some point. Their tracks are everywhere. There's no tracks of our lions coming through, but there are elephant tracks. Jim Butler says, a pear tree with a partridge in residence. Yes, absolutely. This has just sparked the most bizarre memory. We used to do, when I was studying law, 1 week a year, we would all go to a house in the country in the UK where we would sit and study specifically. I mean, we'd discuss law all day, every day. As you can see, that's gone exceptionally well for me. However, this particular house that we would go to had the most bizarre decoration style I have ever seen, including a false pear tree with a stuffed partridge in it. That was one of the worst examples of taxidermy I have ever seen in my life. This thing looked terrifying. It looked like something out of a horror movie. And for some reason, Jib Butler's comment just sparked that particular memory. There was also a tin soldier in the corner at the bottom of the stairs. It was terrifying. And then little gold, or plastic, but sprayed gold cupids hanging from the walls. But for the sake of propriety, the decorators had added leopard print hot pants to them. I'm not quite sure what that was meant to do. I assume that it was completely bizarre. I accidentally broke one of them once and tried to stick it back together with whatever I could find in the house. Very strange experience, my time in that particular place. I like it, Raisa. Weeping Burbine, a Tamburti and a dead leadwood fall in under Raisa's favorite trees. And funnily enough, Raisa, I'm actually heading in a direction of one of our largest weeping Burbines. Weeping Burbines get the most phenomenally bright red flowers during a normal rainy season. They are beautiful trees. Their bark is also quite handy in ridding oneself of a headache, however that headache might have been obtained. Of medicinal use in the seeds, the name Burbine, farmer bean, it's something that the Afrikaans farmers used to use in order, and the voortrekkers used to use to produce coffee, or as a coffee replacement, using the seeds from the Burbine tree, and that's where the name Burbine comes from. Weeping comes from the pollen that the red flowers produce in copious amounts. Tambuertes. Also, we're driving in the perfect area for Raisa's favorite trees. I'm just checking to see. We've got a couple of young ones here, but I wouldn't mind stopping at a nice older specimen. And you know, maybe I should have actually saved this conversation for a trip through the drainage line, or the Buluwati drainage. It has nevertheless been hugely entertaining. So Raisa's favorite trees are Tambuerti trees. They are a crucial part of the ecosystem of this area. They, particularly in drainage line structures, holding the soil in place. Oh, Drongo trying to get the Wahlbergs. Oh, well done, Viam. That is beautiful. Drongos are such tough little birds. I mean, for a little bird like that to go after a raptor that is 20 times bigger than it is always an incredible thing to witness. But drongos in particular are so good at that. Maggie has said that, and Maggie's one of our regular viewers watching in Australia, she said that if I love the Nyala trees of South Africa, I would love the Moreton fig tree or Moreton Bay fig tree. Another one that I'm going to have to go and look up. I'm sure that fig trees in particular, I did mention the sycamore fig, cluster fig is one of my favorites. They are very picturesque trees. For Jamie. Copy that. Let me know if you need any help. Okay, sorry to interrupt our tree conversation, but apparently the monkeys are shouting in the Mawati drainage line. We'll have to do a quick pass-by view of this beautiful boerbeen as we go past. That was Raisa's favorite. Unfortunately, we can't stop now. Things have changed. The situation has changed. And we're going to the Mawati drainage line. I'll slow down ever so slightly as we do a drive-by. This huge, beautiful tree that is Raisa's favorite, the weeping boerbeen. But we can't stop. Sorry, Raisa, and the others who want to watch that. We've got to move on from trees. Monkey's alarm calling could well mean a leopard. Brent apparently has managed to find a hole in the ground, which does happen. And I think Viam must really want to film that. If he'd rather drive past the possibility of a leopard, that's impressive. Yes, we could. Brent getting sleep would be highly entertaining to film. It happens to all of us. We've all done it. I've done it. James has done it. I've done it twice. Three times if you count the stump that I accidentally got stuck on once. It happens. We are going to go, in order to get there, the quickest way for us to get there is to travel along Twin Dams. There is a bit of a dip there that we, oh no, actually, we've popped exactly where I want to be. Right, let us go and find out what is provoking this response from the... check the tracks at the same time as doing this. And while I do, we have a question from one of our viewers about a term that I throw around very casually in conversation, and that is triple M, referring to a road. And yes, Cheryl, it is a road. It is a main access road that runs all the way down the western side of Juma and beyond to Malamala, right down to Londolozi in the south. So yes, it is a road. It is a main access route, and then it then changes into double M once it gets a little bit further to the south. could see the tracks of the monkeys. Let's go sit on the other side of the road and just listen. See if we can't figure out what's been moving through this area. Oh, lion tracks. But those are old. This is from yesterday morning's Birmingham boys. Okay, let's just stop and listen. Brent said he heard monkeys calling from up this part of the drainage line here. First of all, let's see if we can't spot the monkeys. And second of all, let's see if we can't hear them alarm calling. Can you hear them, Vian? Does it sound a little bit like they're further north? Yeah, I've got them. Oh, cross monkeys. Let's go. No time to waste. We have to make a decision here. Do we travel through the Mawati drainage line or do we try and travel up on the top? I'm going to go through the middle. And the reason I'm going to do that is because the whatever their alarm calling at could be either in this drainage line or on either side, and I'd rather have the option of going either which way. What's wrong, monkeys? What have you seen that we haven't? So from their high up vantage point, vervet monkeys are particularly well practiced in spotting the various predators, including leopards. They could also be alarm calling at a snake or a bird, but the way that they're alarm calling immediately suggests to me leopard. So guys, keep your eyes peeled. Look for that flash of white that is the tip of the tail. They're alarm calling just here. Oh, that could be that drainage line around Ingwe Alley as well. Concentrating very hard. I'm going to be fairly quiet for the moment just so that I can listen and track. It's in here somewhere. Y'all are listening and watching the monkeys. Must be somewhere in here. Oh, they're so cross. Aha. They're looking back towards us here. Whoopsie. Brent telling me to go backwards. They're looking outside of Chilepan. Okay, we've got to turn around here. This could be interesting. I'm just gonna go for it. Come on, car, don't get stuck. There's a good Land Rover. Well done, Wendy. This is where speed is of the essence. There is a Warburg soaring above our head. The Franklins are now choosing this moment to have a conversation. Followed monkey alarm calls like this, we found Tingana on Arethusa. Standing by. Copy. Those monkeys look like they were looking west as well. I'll check now. Thank you. Brent, by the way, has obviously made his way out of the hall, so he does not need any further assistance. Well done, Wendy. Starry Night has said to me, be careful, mustn't lose my brakes again. And I did lose my brakes yesterday morning on the Sunrise Safari. Not entirely sure how. I think a casual tree just reached up and pulled the brake line of the back right tire. Luckily, we have the superb Opa to help sort us out. All right. We're going to go across to Chedepan and then we're going to stop and listen. See if we can't hear any alarm calls. I haven't seen any trucks going across the road. I have been moving quite fast. Oh, come on, Leopard. Just be drinking. Just right here would be wonderful. I'm gonna stop and listen. Taking the earpiece out. I can see the monkeys, they've stopped alarm calling. Let's pop my earpiece back in. They are. No, they're still calling. Such a toss-up now between trying to move fast trying to check carefully. Their eyesight, a monkey's eyesight, is so good, and they've got such a good vantage point from where they are. Oh, they're still very cross. They're looking down where Brent was. It. What are you guys seeing? Show me. Point for me. This alarm calls a little bit further ahead. Let's go that way. Drainage line. I just want to check in here very carefully. A leopard moving through this area could be tricky to spot. See if we can't make this a time that a viewer spots the leopard before I do. Certainly wouldn't be a first if VM spots it before I do. Cameramen are very good at finding animals for us. It really does look like the monkeys are saying gobble, 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 gobble. I haven't seen any tracks. which means it's still moving in this drainage line system. Concentrating as hard as possible on not missing anything. So sorry if things are a bit quiet. This particular block, a lot of this tracking will have to be done on foot. Brent was right behind me. He's got off and he's gone for a walk in the drainage line. There's a limit to how far up the Milwati drainage we can go. Thought I saw a flash of movement, but I'm now at that point. You know, when your brain is concentrating so hard on finding something specific that everything turns into it. Anything from a log to a termite mound. It's too far, I think, away from those alarm calls, unless the animal itself is... She's in the road. Her tracks come straight up here, and her scat is in the road. Her scat, fresh scat, right next to me. Brent, I've got Mkhonzo Forma Fuzzy Ingwe and some other fresh signs on Twin Dams just to the north of that drainage line. Copy, thanks, Dave. Where is she? She's got to be somewhere here. The tracks are walking straight up the road. The monkey's still alarm calling. They might be angry enough to keep calling even after she's moved out of their sight. She was just here.
Still got a track there.
Pardon?
Still got a track.
No, I'm just checking. I just wanted to get to this section to double check. I don't still have her tracks. She must have walked into the drainage line. Maybe she's hunting in there. I'm gonna go back to the last position of her tracks, because at this point she could either have gone left or right, most likely right, given the monkey alarm calls. That's also why that Nyala looked so on alert as we drove through. Please, girl, come say hello to everyone. Stopping here, and I'm just going to get off the car. You stay with me, but I'm going to just get off the car. That pile over there is what first alerted me to the possibility of tracks. and I just want to check very carefully where her feet have gone off the road. I'm pretty sure she's gone in here. It's steaming hot.
Smelly.
I can't smell it yet. It's a pity the hyenas have walked over. Looks like she's gone straight off in here. It's so tricky when a hyena's walked down a road at the same place as a leopard. So I definitely have a leopard's tracks, and that's definitely her scat. But now, oh, there's the smell, actually. Now I can smell her. Sudden thought that maybe I was actually... Franklin. I had a sudden thought that maybe she was actually closer than I thought she was. But it is a Franklin sitting on a stump in the thick block. She's walked past here. Now the Franklin's moved out of her way in fear. She's just somewhere in here. All right. Let's hop back in. We'll do another search. Hopefully she's moving back towards the road. Both Brent and myself can't both go off walking in our search. Okay. There's no tracks further past to where I walked up to the car. But the Franklin sitting on a log immediately suggests to me that she cut up in this direction. Leopard. Let's find this girl. I'm sure she's in the drainage line. I'm sure she's cut into the drainage line, but we must have just missed her by a fraction of a couple of minutes. As you can see, in this vegetation, I'm definitely not going to be going off-road without knowing exactly where she is. Hopefully she's going to keep walking. I was listening to that monkey alarm call, and that it could be this and it could be that, but it was most likely a leopard. And Jim, you were wondering about different alarm calls for different animals, and yes, the monkeys and the squirrels, all of the animals have different codes for different animals. So we'll check really carefully in here. Jim, we might not be as well versed as the other animals are in terms of interpreting their alarm calls, but there are different styles. We, at least to our uninformed human ear, we can hear the difference, especially with monkeys. They get a very frantic, harsh sound to their reaction to leopards, and that's because they know that a leopard, if it chooses to, could go after them. Oh, there we go. Standing by. On Twin Dams itself, and very fresh signs of her, just to the north of that drainage line, I've marked them, and they look like they don't carry on north up the road, they look like they go drop east back towards the drainage line. The scat is still warm, just checking along this road. I'll go back and walk from last tracks. So Brent and myself just discussing how we're going to go about this. I think that I'm going to go back towards where the last tracks were, do a little bit of a walk in the drainage line. While I do that, let's find out how Brent's search has gone.
So exciting. I think it could be Karula. We did have her tracks coming in earlier on today, but quite far from here, so it looks like she's done some serious distance. And unfortunately, as we heard those monkeys and we jumped down into the drainage line, as we're trying to turn around to where the monkeys were looking, I wasn't looking behind me, and we fell into a very big hole that the elephants had dug in the riverbed. So we got stuck. Well, we weren't stuck, we were temporarily unable to move. You're only stuck when you have to call for help. That is the rule. So if you have to get someone else to come pull you, push you, or help you, then you are stuck. If you get yourselves out, it is not stuck. So you might notice that in our rush to find this leopard, I didn't put our jack back. I've just popped it next to me for now. I'll put it back later. But I think we've got a really good chance of finding her. Jamie walk in on those really fresh tracks. I'm gonna jump up ahead of Jamie and try to do a bit of guesswork. So try think where, if I was Karula, would I pop out next? So hopefully we'll be able to put a cat out of the bag before the end of the sunrise safari. Justin says, come on, Karula, it feels like forever since we last saw you. Well, Justin, it was last week Thursday, I think, that we last saw Karula. Sorry, I've just heard Franklin shouting. Let's just double check, because we know how the Queen likes to change her mind and her direction. Always just worth checking all those little signs. You never know when they might come to fruition. Let's stick to our original plan. Check again as we go past. What we're looking for is that white flick of the tail. But it has been an exciting morning. And wonderful that that unrelaxed male is still there. Now, wouldn't it be incredible to go to the other end of the spectrum with one of the most relaxed female leopards in the Sabi Sands? So this is where the monkeys were, and where we got temporarily delayed was just on the other side there. I think we must have been, I think if we hadn't have got temporary delayed, we would have been about 30 seconds behind her. But that is part and parcel of being out in the bush. I had last tracks when I was on foot somewhere in here. It sounds like Jamie's got tracks further ahead. So Jamie's on the hot set. James Richard has made a very astute observation. You can see why a leopard's hunting success rate is so low when there's so many sets of eyes waiting to tell everyone where they are. That's true, monkeys, squirrels, birds, impala. And there's Vim, he's been abandoned. Hopefully Jamie took the keys so Vim doesn't leave her behind. Hello, Vimpy. How are you doing? Stretching your legs?
Mm-hmm.
Where was the last track?
By the stinky pool there.
Yes, I saw that. Going in. Yeah. I'm going to go around towards the dam and then come into the drainage line from the northern side.
Sure.
Okay.
Sweet.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, it's so fun catching VM on camera. He's looking at me with a big grin on his face as we drive off. We are very lucky to have such a great group of cameramen to work with, even though some of them do some silly things sometimes. And one will notice that DeJandre hasn't been on camera for a few days, and that's not due to the fact he is on leave. It's due to the fact he learnt a valuable bush lesson about how to use a high-lift jack. And the jack turned around and said hello and bit his foot quite severely, but fortunately no breaks. He's just a hop along at the moment. Got no tracks coming out here. Jamie is on her way back to the vehicle, so we'll get an update from her in two shakes of a lamb's tail. And I think she's still in the little riverbed, the Mawati. So I'm just gonna loop around. And it's one of my little secret roads that pops into the drainage system. See if we can second guess her and get up ahead of her.
Brent, can we pick up any tracks all the way down towards the drainage line? But it's so thick in there, I could have walked within 10 metres of her and never known.
Copy, thanks. I'm going to go around and drop into the drainage from the eastern, northeastern side.
Copy, I'll continue up towards where Taylor Dam, just in the hope that maybe she comes back up the side.
Copy. Now, you might notice there's a huge amount of buzzing irritants around this morning. So this hot weather after the rain, and the fly populations have exploded. And of course, as soon as you come near an area where buffalo hang out, you know, I think a lot of these flies are waiting for the Duggar boys to come down to wallow. She's somewhere down here. Just have a quick look from up top. Further behind. We always know Queen Karula might pop out over here as well, so we will keep an eye out for the tracks on the road. But I'm pretty confident she's still in this wonderfully beautiful, thick little river system. So here's one of these wonderful little secret roads, or not so secret roads, that we use from time to time to access the drainage lines. Now they're not as obvious as they were, but there we go, you can actually see the tracks here. So where Jamie last had tracks is probably almost directly opposite us, so there's a good chance that that leopard is around, so keep your eyes peeled, Dangerous Dave. We have some comedians out there today, and Spotted Aussie says, leopard can't hide very well, they're always spotted, ha ha. Now, have a look there. There's a big monitor lizard. That's not what we're looking for. You see him, Dave?
Yeah.
Hello, monitor. Basking in the sun. We're looking for a slightly bigger predator than that. Very relaxed, big monitor. Sorry, dude. Can't drive through the van, I have to go around it. So we have had many Karula sightings in this particular area. Hasn't got here yet because there's some nyalas. We think she's probably a little bit further downstream. Hello, little nyalas. Be careful. There's a leopard in the area, but I'm sure they're well aware of that after all the noise those monkeys made. This is what she would be hunting for in this area. Nyala, bushbuck, maybe the odd duiker. Jamie had last tracks there. We can't really go much further than this, so we're just gonna stop and have a look and see downstream a bit. Confident she's around.